Well, hello, friends. How's it going? Yeah, okay. A little energy on Sunday morning. We love to hear it. If we haven't met before, my name's Dawson. I'm glad you're here. I think HSM is a fantastic place to be on the weekend, and you guys chose a great Sunday to be here. I'm curious. I heard a few of the favorite movies in the crowd, and I heard someone say Princess Bride. Do we have any other Princess Bride fans in the house today? Okay, a few of us. Good. I'm glad. It came out in 1987, like before I was born. So if you haven't seen it, I don't blame you. But real quick, raise your hand if you have Disney Plus. Okay, if you haven't seen it, find one of these people after service, get their login, and watch it today. That is your homework this week, because it is a fantastic movie, you guys. It's so good. And I love the way it starts. It starts so creatively. There's this boy who's sick in bed, doesn't go to school. And his grandpa comes in and asks if he can read him a book that his dad read to him when he was sick, and he read to his son when he was sick, and now he's asking to read it to his grandson as he is sick from school. And the grandson asks the only natural question: are there any sports in it? Are there any sports in it? And the grandpa says, are you kidding? There's fencing, fighting, torture, revenge, giants, monsters, chases, escapes, true love, and miracles. Are there sports in it? And the kid's like, well, I guess it doesn't sound so bad. You can go ahead and read it to me. And so the grandpa begins, and this Princess Bride book opens with this kind of boring opening scene on a farm, with this woman named Buttercup falling in love with her farmhand, and the kid stops the grandpa. He's like, hold on. Is this one of those kissing books? This is so boring. And the grandpa says, hey, just wait a second. We will get to all that excitement. We will get to all the fencing and fighting and torture. That will all come. But the grandpa understands something that the kid doesn't quite understand yet. Every good story needs context. Every good story, we need an opening scene to understand what's the original tension. What's the hopes and dreams and desires of the characters? Where does the story take place? When does the story take place? Every good story needs good context. And in order to fully understand the story, we have to orient ourselves towards the opening scene. In this whole series, we're talking about the gospel story, the story that Joshua just shared up here on stage. And if you've been to church once or a million times, my guess is that story is not unfamiliar to you. We're not surprised by the outcome that Jesus is victorious. But in this story, we need to understand the original opening scene to really grasp the depth of the rest of the story. So today, that's what we're going to do. We're going to orient ourselves towards the very first page of the very first book of our Bible, the opening scene that happens in Genesis. We see immediately out of the gate that God creates everything. He separates and orders and creates, and then it picks up in Genesis 1:26 and says this. You can follow along on the screens or on your outlines. Then God said, "Let us make human beings in our image to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, and all the wild animals on earth, and the small animals that scurry across the ground." So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and govern it. Reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, and the animals that scurry along the ground." Then God said, "Look, I have given you every seed-bearing plant throughout the earth and all the fruit trees for your food. And I have given every green plant as food for the wild animals, the birds in the sky, and the animals that scurry along the ground." Man, these animals that scurry along the ground, they're everywhere. "Everything that has life." And that's what happened. Then God looked out over all he had made and said, "It was very good." And evening passed and morning came, marking the sixth day. When we look at this creation story, I think this creation story gives us three markers that we really have to understand that remain true for the rest of the story. That if we don't understand these three markers, we don't really grasp the rest of the story. And the first marker is this. The first marker that we learn is that we were made by a good God. We were made by a good God. There's this famous quote that says this: what comes into our mind when we think about God is the most important thing about us. What comes into your and my mind when we think about God, when someone says the name of God, when you show up to church and the name of God is spoken on stage, what comes to your mind is the most important thing about you, because it determines a lot of your perspective of the world. I don't know about you, often when somebody says the name God, what comes to my mind immediately is Morgan Freeman in his white suit in some of the movies and his deep, silky voice pretending to be God. Or maybe you think of Jesus from The Chosen and his down-to-earthness and the miracles he performs. Or maybe your view is a little bit more like the bearded guy with long white hair looking down over the earth, just shaking his head saying, "What are you guys doing?" What comes into our mind when we think about God is the most important thing about us. No matter what your perspective is, I think we have an opportunity today to look at the story and see what is true. See, really, what should we think when we think about God? And the first thing that we see that God does in this opening scene is that he creates goodness and order from chaos and disorder. The Bible tells us that when the world was formed, it was formless and void, this chaotic nothingness. Sounds absolutely terrifying. I would not want to be there. But from this chaotic nothingness, God brings a beautiful creation. God brings a garden that's fruitful and whole and good, where life thrives. We see in this opening scene that God is creative and he's loving, that he made all of the animals, the reptiles, the birds, the fish, the dolphins, the monkeys, and then he makes the pinnacle of his creation, humans, to be like him. He's proud of his creation, and he's a caring creator. We see that his first action with humans is to entrust them with responsibility, with ruling with him, inviting them to join him in ruling over this garden. We see that God gives them everything that they need in the garden. Mankind has everything that they need: food, a place to call home, even a relationship with God. We actually see later in the story, a few chapters later, that God is walking around in the garden in relationship with his creation. He didn't just create and dip out and say, "Figure it out, have fun." He created and then he was there in relationship with Adam and Eve. We see so much in this creation story that tells us that God is a good God. He's a God who makes beautiful things, lives in relationship with us, trusts us with responsibility, provides everything that we need. The second marker that you and I see in this story is it's more about us, that we were made as a good creation. We were made as a good creation. God creates a variety of life, plants, animals, but creation isn't finished until he makes the pinnacle creation, mankind, Adam and Eve, you and me, humans. And then he looks out over all creation and says, not only is it good, it is very good. It is whole. It is right. You and me are the last thing he makes, and then his work is finished. And I love this. God makes us in his image, which is so important. It really speaks to your and my value. It speaks to how loved we are, that we are so deeply loved by God, that we were literally made by love. Think about this. Life is the natural byproduct of love, right? Like, take marriage, for example. When a man or a woman decide to tie the knot and get married and they begin to foster a deeper relationship and foster more love for each other, the natural next step is to have a kid. The natural next step is that love for each other births life. And that life reflects the creators, right? That life, that baby looks like the mom and dad, acts like the mom and dad, has the same mannerisms, eventually uses the same phrases and words. That baby, that creation, reflects the creator. And humans didn't just make up this idea of life being created by love. It's a reflection of this original story, that from God, who is love, he makes life. Life springs forward. You and me are created by love. And we were created to reflect and represent God. We're created to reflect and represent God. You can write that down on your outline. We're created to reflect and represent God. Just like that baby reflects, looks like mom and dad, and represents them everywhere they go, they share that last name. You and I were created to look like God, to be made in his image, and steward the creation that he's given us. As I was preparing for this message this week, someone pointed out something really interesting about this story that I didn't grasp the first time I read over it. When you think of a day, when we think of a day in our mind today, we think of like a day starts in the morning and you get your Starbucks and you wake up and you go to school or you go to work, and then it finishes with evening and you've got Netflix and winding down and going to bed and resting at night. But the way that this story is written is flipped. It says there was evening and there was morning the first day. There was evening, there was morning the second day. There was evening, there was morning the third day. So on and so forth. After God creates humans, the very first thing that humans experience is evening. They experience rest. And then, from the overflow of rest and the love that they were created in, they pour out their work the next morning. So often, our value is tied to our work. Our value is tied to what we accomplish, what we do throughout the day, how good of grades we have, how popular, how much approval we have, what we did on our sports team. But God says, no, your value is tied to who created you. You are a good creation, and you first get to rest in the love and the identity God has given you. And then from that rest, we get to pour out in overflow. You and I are a good creation made by a good God. This final foundational marker that we see in this story is more about our role in the world. What were we made to do? We see it a little bit in Genesis 1, 29 and 30, where God creates everything and gives it to man to rule over and watch over. In Genesis 2, 15, it even says it more clearly. It says it this way. The Lord God placed man in the Garden of Eden to tend and watch over it. To tend and watch over it. And in this verse, there's an invitation, not just for Adam and Eve back then, but for you and I today. And it's that you and I were made to partner with God for good works. You and I were made to partner with God for good works. I believe that should come up on the screen there. We are made to partner with God for good works. God didn't just create us and peace out, like I said earlier. God created us with an end goal in mind, with this idea of what we could do, and that's to partner with him. God creates this garden, but creation isn't complete until he places Adam and Eve in the garden and says, go, partner with me in making sure that this garden continues to bring forth beautiful creation and rule over this land in a way that is honoring to me, that reflects and represents me. God creates this garden goodness, this place of wholeness where humans are safe and loved and whole, and then invites us to join in creating garden goodness. It reminds me of growing up in Illinois. One of the chores that my dad would do growing up every single week is mow the lawn. Anybody in here mow their own lawn out of curiosity? Okay, we've got a couple, yeah. So my dad would get the lawnmower out, fill up the oil, fill up the gas, check the oil, make sure it was running, start it up, and then he would comb over every inch of that lawn to make sure that the grass that was getting unruly was freshly cut and looked beautiful and good, and our lawn was organized. And us kids wanted so badly to do whatever dad was doing that one of us would ride on his shoulders and the other would push that little toy lawnmower behind him that did absolutely nothing. But we thought we were helping out, when in fact we were making it a little bit harder. But our dad still participated with us in that way. And then as we grew up, the goal wasn't for us to just simply watch our dad and kind of help out. My dad taught us, here's where you put in the oil. Here's where you put in the gas. Here's how you check the blade to make sure there's no dings in it. Here's how you turn the lawnmower. Here's how you start it up. And then he would watch us do it. And then eventually, my dad wouldn't even be there, but it became our weekly chore to mow the lawn, to take care of this land in front of our house. I know it's kind of a silly example, and God's not asking us necessarily to mow lawns. But what he is asking us, he's saying, I created this garden goodness, this beautiful world, and now I'm giving it to you to help create more garden goodness, to rule over it in a way that is just like I would, a way that reflects and represents me. It's not our job to go actually create a garden necessarily. He's not asking us to go grow basil and carrots and celery and tomatoes, although a salad is delicious. But what he's asking for us is to bring garden goodness to our friendships. Through speaking words of life to people, through encouraging and building others up so that our words are reflecting God to them. What he's asking us to do is bring garden goodness to our families. To wash the dishes and take out the trash without anyone asking, not because it's the right thing to do, because it serves our families in a way that reflects and represents Jesus. You and I get to bring about garden goodness through our words and our actions. Maybe write that down, words and actions. At school, on our sports teams, we get to speak in ways that honor God and build others up and act in ways that God would be proud of you for. Seeing the outsider, loving the person who seems to be a little less popular on the team or in our musical. God invites us to bring garden goodness to our ASB and the Coldstone that we work at, and our families, and our friendships, and our math class, and at night before we go to bed, and to church on Saturday or Sunday. God invites us to bring this garden goodness that he started in creating, but then invites us to partner in bringing about. I love this. God invites us to bring garden goodness to reflect and represent him through our words and our actions. My friend Logan is a great example of this. Logan's actually here today, and I invited her to share her testimony about how God has shaped her and met her and then used her to serve and bring garden goodness in all areas of her life. Would you give Logan a round of applause as she comes up to stage?
Hi, I'm Logan, and I'm a senior at Tribuco Hills High School. I didn't grow up in the typical Christian home where you attend church every week and pray at every meal, but I always knew about Jesus because of my friends. I grew up attending church occasionally with my friend and her family, but I was very confused with who Jesus was and found myself getting bored and not enjoying the services. Towards the end of sixth grade, I started going to Saddleback with a group of my school friends, and I really enjoyed it. As I was starting seventh grade, I went to JHM and joined a life group. At this point in my life, I knew God, but did not prioritize him in my life. I was a competitive gymnast at the time and put all my focus on that. All of my worth focused on my performance, and this ended up making me forget how much Jesus loves and cares about me. Eventually, I quit gymnastics and was ready to focus on Jesus. I went to HSM camp for the first time as a freshman and truly felt God and accepted him as my savior. On the last day of camp, I walked through the door and was so excited to take my faith seriously. A month after camp, I got baptized with one of my best friends, and I felt so much love in my church community. After receiving a Kingdom Worker card at HSM camp, I finally decided to be bold and follow what it said. A Kingdom Worker card is a card that you randomly select, and it tells you to commit to taking a next step in your faith. My card said to start serving with Saddleback Kids. I finally had the time to take on this role and jumped into serving with first grade a month after camp. Serving with Saddleback Kids changed my life in so many different ways. I was able to grow a love for kids that I never thought I had. It was so cool seeing the way God moves through kids, regardless of how young they are. The leaders and students give me the best advice and make me feel welcome every week. Even though I was still serving and staying connected to God, I was struggling with anxiety and depression. I let these things define me, and eventually this drew me pretty far from God. I was isolating myself from my family and friends and had no motivation to go to school or hang out with my friends. I felt as if I was going through all of this on my own. As I was approaching my junior year of HSM camp, I was feeling defeated and hopeless. This year at camp was hard, but completely life-changing. I was able to connect with my life group leaders about how I was truly feeling. They were able to support me through this time while drawing me closer to God. I was also able to open up to my mom, and she was able to provide me with the help I needed. Even though I was going through such a hard time, I still made sure I went to HSM on Saturday nights, life group on Wednesdays, and Saddleback Kids on Sunday mornings. Staying connected to God, even when I felt so far from him, encouraged me to have hope and put all my trust into him. A verse that got me through this hard time was Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. When things feel impossible, God is there no matter what, and he will help you overcome any battle. In January of this year, I started reading my Bible every morning on my own, and this is where I felt God come back into my life. I was determined to stay committed to him and trust him even when things were hard. I started serving with JHM in the beginning of April, and although it was scary and outside of my comfort zone, I knew God was calling me to serve there, so I accepted his invitation. JHM has taught me so many things and brought me even closer to God. When life was hard, I made sure to focus on Jesus, and this changed my life for the better. Now I know that he's always there for me, regardless of my circumstances. I'm so grateful to be surrounded by an amazing life group and church community that has brought me so much joy. Through it all, put your hope in Jesus and trust his plan for you. Thank you for listening to my testimony.
So amazing. Friends, Logan, I love the way that God used your life. I love that you have a great view of God, that we serve a good God, and that you understand that you are a good creation. And by aligning those two, you've been able to pour out good works that God has asked to partner with you on. That's amazing. I love the way that Ephesians 2:10 puts it when it says this, that you and I are God's masterpiece, that he created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things that he planned for us long ago. We serve a masterful creator, a creator who made you and me a masterpiece, a good creation, so that we could jump into the works that he planned for each of you a long time ago, before you were ever born or a thought in your parents' mind. He planned good works for you and only you to accomplish by his power. Maybe today, you just need to hear point one. You just need to hear this first foundational marker that we have a good God who made the universe. That God is not unkind, unjust, or unfair, that he is a good God who creates good and beautiful creations. Maybe you need to be reminded of that second marker, that you're a good creation, that God loves you not because of what you do, what you accomplish, what your day holds, but he loves you because you're his masterful creation. He loves you so much that he sent Jesus for you, simply to offer you a relationship with him once more. Maybe today you already knew that we serve a good God, that you are a good creation, but God is inviting you and even challenging you to step into garden goodness in areas of your life. To say, hey, I am going to bring about things that reflect and represent God through my words and actions in all areas of my life, because it honors God and it helps me partner in the good work that he has invited me into and planned for me long ago. Our Bible ends in a really similar place that it begins. It ends in this place of a garden, of a new creation being made whole once more by God. This garden goodness, this wholeness, this freshness, this rightness blooming once more. And you and I, we get to work towards that through a relationship with God, through his power. Would you pray with me? God, thank you. Thank you that you are a good God, that we don't have a God who is just shaking his head, looking down at the world, but you are a God who is full of love. And through that love, you created us. A good creation that you declared over all creation, that it was very good, that it was whole, that it was right, and that you loved us so much that you would offer relationship to us once more through Jesus and his death and resurrection. Lord, today, would you help inspire us, help create boldness in us, help create courage in us to bring garden goodness to everywhere we go, our friend groups, our families, Lord, our schools, our work, to our enemies, to the people who are hard to love. Would you help us bring garden goodness words that reflect and represent you, actions that reflect and represent you everywhere we go, to bring about once more this flourishing garden where our Bible ends the story. We love you. We praise your name.